Our hereditary information is carried in large molecules called deoxyribonucleic acid, or DNA. Just like all other molecules, DNA is governed by the laws of chemistry. In the Foundations 2 tutorial, we explored bonding, and we can apply these principles to better understand the structure of DNA. Take a look at DNA. This image shows two DNA molecules that have come together to form a double-stranded structure. Each strand, which is a molecule of DNA, is a polymer of nucleotides. A polymer is a molecule that is made up of repeating units, called monomers, that are covalently bonded together. The monomers of DNA are nucleotides, and they're shown here. Each nucleotide is made up of a phosphate group, a deoxyribose sugar, and a nitrogenous base, covalently bonded together. So in a sense, DNA is a series of stacked nucleotides. When the two DNA molecules come together, those stacked nucleotides look like this. Another way to think about DNA is as a backbone made up of alternating phosphate and deoxyribose sugars with nitrogenous bases projecting off of that backbone. In this tutorial, we'll start by reviewing the chemistry of the backbone, and then we'll look at the chemistry of the nitrogenous bases. Here's a close-up of deoxyribose. Here, all the bonds are drawn in, but remember from the last tutorial that a simplified drawing of deoxyribose looks like this. Notice all of the carbon-oxygen bonds in deoxyribose. Oxygen is more electronegative than carbon, so the bonds between carbon and oxygen are polar covalent bonds. Deoxyribose has 5 carbon atoms, and we label them from 1 prime to 5 prime, like this. Biologists often refer to this labeling when talking about DNA. Deoxyribose is very similar to a different sugar called ribose. The only difference between ribose and deoxyribose is that deoxyribose is missing an OH group at the 2' carbon. This is how deoxyribose gets its name. It's a deoxygenated version of ribose. Here's a close-up of phosphate. The oxygen atoms are covalently bonded to the phosphorus atom, but notice that the oxygen atoms are negatively charged. This is because there was electron transfer between the oxygen atoms and hydrogen atoms, but the hydrogen atoms dissociated into the watery environment of the cell, leaving the negatively charged oxygen atoms of phosphate. The backbone of DNA is made up of alternating deoxyribose and phosphate, covalently bonded together. 2 oxygen atoms from each phosphate group are linked to deoxyribose sugars, and each deoxyribose sugar is linked to 2 phosphate groups. One at the 3' carbon, and one at the 5' carbon. These bonds that join deoxyribose and phosphate are polar covalent bonds called phosphodiester bonds. We use the numbering of deoxyribose to label the two ends of a DNA strand. The end with a 5' carbon bound only to phosphate is the 5' end, and the end with a 3' carbon bound to the OH of deoxyribose is the 3' end. Now, let's think about the nitrogenous bases that project off this backbone. The sequence of these nitrogenous bases is really important because this is what encodes your genes. In DNA, there are 4 different nitrogenous bases, thymine, cytosine, adenine, and guanine, which are usually abbreviated T, C, A, and G. These bases are divided into 2 categories, the pyrimidines and the purines. Pyrimidines are made of 1 chemical ring, or atoms that are covalently bonded into the shape of a ring. Thymine and cytosine are pyrimidines. Purines are made of 2 chemical rings, and adenine and guanine are purines. All of the nitrogenous bases have some polar covalent bonds, forming some partially negative and some partially positive atoms. Here, I've drawn the partially negative atoms in blue and the partially positive atoms in red. Remember that these partial charges are formed because of electronegativity differences between the atoms forming the polar covalent bond. Nitrogenous bases are covalently bonded to the 1' carbon of deoxyribose. Here's a deoxyribose sugar, and here's the 1' carbon. The covalent bond between deoxyribose and a nitrogenous base is formed through a condensation reaction. A condensation reaction is the joining of 2 molecules, in this case, deoxyribose and thymine, with the loss of a small molecule, in this case, water. So these atoms leave as water, and a covalent bond is formed between the 1' carbon of deoxyribose and this nitrogen of thymine. A similar reaction occurs to join the other nitrogenous bases with deoxyribose. We'll see many more examples of condensation reactions when we study metabolism. The bond between deoxyribose and a nitrogenous base is called a glycosidic bond, and it was formed through a condensation reaction. Let's connect this to the structure of the backbone that we just looked at. Here's what we drew for the backbone. We know that nitrogenous bases are bonded to the 1' carbon of deoxyribose. I've chosen arbitrary bases, and here's what a segment of a DNA strand could look like. So far, we've looked at the structure of one strand of DNA, which is one molecule of DNA. But DNA is double-stranded. The interaction of two DNA strands all comes down to the nitrogenous bases. Here's part of the backbone of a second strand of DNA. The nitrogenous bases on this strand determine whether or not it can interact with the strand we've already drawn. There are two major factors that determine how the strands interact: size compatibility and hydrogen bonding. Going back up to the nitrogenous bases we drew, we can see that they differ in size. Pyrimidines are made of one chemical ring, while purines are made of two. This makes pyrimidines and purines very different in size. In order for these two strands to fit together without bulges or spaces, a large nitrogenous base must interact with a small one, so a purine must pair with a pyrimidine. But these interactions are very specific. Guanine doesn't pair with thymine, it only pairs with cytosine. And in DNA, thymine specifically pairs with adenine. The reason for this specificity is hydrogen bonding. Drawing in these complementary base pairs, we see that the second strand of DNA looks like this. These bases interact through hydrogen bonding, which I've drawn in orange. Maximum hydrogen bonding only occurs between thymine and adenine, and between guanine and cytosine, and this helps explain the base pairing specificity. Notice that three hydrogen bonds are formed between guanine and cytosine, while only two hydrogen bonds are formed between adenine and thymine. There's more attraction holding guanine and cytosine together, so base pairing is slightly stronger between G and C than between A and T. When two DNA strands come together to form double-stranded DNA, the strands are antiparallel. In other words, they run in opposite directions. This DNA strand is from 5' to 3' in this direction, and the complementary DNA strand is from 5' to 3' in the other direction. Remember that hydrogen bonds are much weaker than covalent bonds. While each hydrogen bond is weak, along the entire length of two DNA strands, these weak hydrogen bonds add up to a lot, and they're very effective at holding the strands together. This cumulative effect has huge implications for DNA replication and transcription. A strand of DNA pairs only with its complementary strand because of base pair specificity that comes from size and hydrogen bonding. And the cumulative strength of all the hydrogen bonds together keeps the two strands in the same part of the cell. But when the strand needs to be replicated, it isn't difficult to break a few hydrogen bonds to open up the strands at the replication fork, because each individual hydrogen bond is weak. The overall structure of DNA is a double helix. It's double because two strands of DNA come together via base pairing. It's also helical, which means that the two strands twist around each other. This allows the base pairs to interact maximally. RNA behaves very similarly to DNA. RNA is also a polymer of nucleotides, and it also has nitrogenous bases projecting off a backbone. There are three major differences between DNA and RNA. The first is that RNA has ribose as a sugar instead of deoxyribose. We saw at the beginning of the tutorial that the difference between ribose and deoxyribose is the OH group bonded to the 2' carbon. In RNA, this OH prevents really tight formation of the double helix. Which brings us to the second difference between DNA and RNA. Because of this OH group that prevents tight formation of the double helix, RNA is generally single-stranded. The third difference is that RNA uses uracil as a nitrogenous base instead of thymine. Here are the nitrogenous bases of DNA. In RNA, adenine, guanine, and cytosine are exactly the same. But instead of thymine, RNA uses uracil. Here's what uracil looks like. The only difference between uracil and thymine is a CH3 group, or methyl group, that's bonded to thymine but not to uracil. So take a look again. Here's thymine with the CH3 group, and here's uracil without it. To summarize, there are three major differences between DNA and RNA. DNA has deoxyribose, while RNA has ribose. DNA is double-stranded, while RNA is often single-stranded. And DNA has thymine, while RNA has uracil.